In this video, we're going to be taking a look at an online course called The Fossil Record versus Evolution, put out by Educate for Life and starring young Earth creationist Kevin Conover. I found out about this class because I've taken a lot of online courses over the last few years, and I get emails from classcentral.com, so I clicked on the link for Evolution and saw these courses, you know, Charles Darwin, Evolution, Tropical Australia, taking that one, Origins of Human Language, taking that one. How We Date Human Evolution, took that this last year. Understanding and Teaching Evolution, just finished that one about a month or so ago. Then I see this one at the bottom, The Fossil Record versus Evolution. I had to check it out. So I click on the link and it takes me here. It looks like it's about creationism, but I decided to do a little bit more research, so I went on to their website. They got a good looking website. I wonder what it says about Kevin Conover. Turns out Kevin has a master's degree in apologetics. He lives in San Diego. He's been handcuffed to an atheist. And he hosts Education for Life Radio, a weekly program in San Diego, California. Turns out he's friends with Eric Hoven. And Eric says, did you know that 7 out of 10 kids leave church right after high school? You know, Eric doesn't mention one of the main reasons for that is because they were taught lies of young earth creationism, but that's a whole other video. So anyway, Eric goes on to ask for money. That's what Eric does best. Eric likes money. But let's get on with the online course. I show the intro, but then I skip a bit and I go on where he starts talking about human evolution.
Welcome to Educate for Life Online. This is the first lesson in our first class series, Created on Purpose or Evolved by Chance. This lesson is called The Fossil Record versus Evolution, and we're going to look at whether the fossil evidence points towards evolution as Darwinists claim, or if it offers support for creation. We'll examine the alleged human ancestors that have come and gone over the years, as well as several of the most commonly cited examples of missing links. No one can observe the distant past, but looking at fossils is very helpful in determining what has happened in the past. Let's see which side of the creation-evolution debate has the best claim to the fossil evidence. Okay, so let's look at fake missing links between monkey and man. Now, an evolutionist might say, but evolution doesn't say that humans evolved from monkeys. We're far more closely related to apes. Not from any modern species of monkey, but it does teach that all primates, monkeys, apes, and humans share a common chimp-like ancestor.
No, we don't say that all primates, monkeys, apes, and humans share a common chimp-like ancestor. That'd be silly. We split with chimps maybe 8 million years ago. We split with primates and monkeys long before that.
So let's look at the first one here. It's Ramapithecus. Ramapithecus was once considered to be a transitional form between monkeys and man. The first incomplete fossil specimen of Ramapithecus was found by G. Edward Lewis in 1932 on the bank of the Tenau River in the western part of Nepal. Lewis came to the conclusion that this was a transitional form when he had found a fragment of a jaw and several teeth. You'll notice you can see over there on the right, that's all he found was the fragment of a jaw and several teeth, and these monkeys were all drawn, or these missing links were all drawn, based off of a jaw and teeth. For around 30 years, evolutionists perpetuated the myth that there were transitional forms showing man came from monkeys. It wasn't until the 1960s that evolutionists reluctantly concluded that Ramapithecus was an extinct kind of orangutan.
No. Back in the 1930s, when we had only discovered a few fossils, they thought it was possible that Ramapithecus might have been transitional between earlier apes and us. But yeah, by the 1960s, they realized that it wasn't an extinct form of orangutan. It was transitional between earlier apes and orangutans.
And so, you know, kids walk into museums and they see these little dolls basically doctored up to look like, oh, wow, look, there's your missing link. What they don't tell you is all that was found was a jaw and some teeth, and they concocted this entire missing link. Now, evolutionists have admitted this is not a missing link. Why talk about it if evolutionists have admitted it's not a missing link?
Oh, I know. It's because you haven't studied this and you're reading from some really old creationist literature.
Well, what we want to look at is establish a track record. I want you to help you become a little bit skeptical when these missing links pop up. What are missing links really made of? Well, again, Ramapithecus was made of nothing but a jaw and several teeth.
Actually, Ramapithecus was reclassified as Civipithecus, and we have a lot of fossils, including almost complete skulls.
Let's look at the next one here. After Ramapithecus comes a guy that's name has to do with coffee. If you want to think about which one it is there, that third one.
Psst, I'll give you a hint. And this is where the online course gets really, really bad.
See if you can think about it. It has something to do with coffee, not Starbucks. Java Man. Okay, and the reason they call him Java Man is because he was found in Java. Another alleged link was called Homo erectus or Java Man. Eugene Dubois discovered the fossils in Java in 1891. Today it's widely accepted that the fossils were a gibbon monkey skull combined with a human leg bone. The leg bone was found 50 feet away from the skull. Now, I don't know how you die and you have your leg bone found, you know, blown 50 feet away from your skull, but if you consider that a paleontologist is generally desperate to find evidence of evolution, it makes more sense.
Whoa! Well, first of all, it's really not uncommon to find scattered bones after something dies. There's these things called predators. And it's not widely accepted that Java Man was a gibbon monkey combined with a human leg bone. That's ridiculous. Java Man is actually Homo erectus. We have hundreds of fossils. They lived for 1.5 million years. They were found in Africa and Asia and clearly transitional species between earlier apes and us.
Please keep in mind that when somebody that is a paleontologist is going out and looking for missing links, they're often paid money to find missing links. And so today, people get grants up into the millions of dollars in order to accomplish a goal. And if your paycheck is dependent upon you finding a missing link, well, you're going to go out and you're going to work really hard at trying to find that missing link. And some people have deceived people in order to get paid, essentially.
Yeah, they sure have. But it's not the paleontologists doing it. None of them are getting paid $1 million to go out and find fossils.
Sad but true. There are multiple sites dedicated to identifying fraud in science, and sometimes that happens. Scientists aren't perfect people. They make mistakes like everybody else, and they often have ulterior motives like other people do. And sometimes they fall prey to greed or desperation. It took more than 100 years for evolutionists to admit that Java Man was no missing link. In 1996, Carl Swisher of the Berkeley Geochronology Center published his discovery that Java Man lived in the era of modern humans, ruling it out as an evolutionary ancestor. You can look that up. I have my source there.
Did check your source. While I was there, I looked around a little bit. It was the Institution for Creation Research, and they also say 8 years ago that Java Man is now dated at over 500,000 years old, rendering your earlier source invalid.
And so what you have here is a lie that was perpetuated for 100 years. Well, what happens when you tell lies in elementary school, high school, college for 100 years? Well, people begin to believe it, and they don't always go back and check the facts, and they don't always get made aware of the fact that Java Man turned out not to be a missing link. And so you have this idea of evolution being true, perpetuated, and filtering out throughout society. So Java Man ended up being a gibbon monkey skull and a human leg bone found 50 feet away.
Nope. Java Man ended up being Homo erectus with hundreds of fossil specimens and a great example of a transitional species.
Let's look at the next one after Java Man, the very famous one named after a girl. The answer is Lucy.
I can't believe he got this backwards. I mean, Australopithecus comes before Homo erectus. Everyone knows this.
Okay, no, not Lucy from Peanuts. Different Lucy. She was named by Don Johansson. The skeleton of Lucy, also known as Australopithecus afarensis, was about 40% complete when unearthed by Don Johansson in 1974. Now, he gave her the name Lucy based off of a Beatles song, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. Now, that song, interestingly enough, is a song about LSD, right? Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. And you can decide if that name is appropriate or not. I'll leave that decision up to you.
Where have I heard that before? Sounds so familiar. Where was it? Oh, yeah.
And they named it Lucy because he was listening to the song that was popular at the time called Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds by the Beatles, which has the initials LSD on purpose. Yeah. Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
Now, if you look here, the Chicago Field Museum has a display of Lucy, and it says the human story begins, and it goes into this long thing about the how Lucy evolved and how she's our ancestor and everything else. And if I zoom in on it, it says the hominid story is still being written. There are gaps in the fossil record and many fossils are fragmentary, but each new discovery brings us closer to a clear picture of human evolution. Though this emerging picture can be controversial, scientists agree on two key points. Now keep in mind that right there, scientists agree. Humans evolved from an ape-like ancestor and they evolved through the same unpredictable process as every other living thing. Now, what do they mean here when they say scientists agree? Is it true that all scientists agree that humans evolved from an ape ancestor and that they evolved through an unpredictable process like every other living thing? Do all scientists agree with this?
But that's not what he said, was it? He didn't say all scientists. If you ask a paleoanthropologist, they'll agree.
Well, obviously they don't. But what's the point in saying scientists agree? Well, it's what they're saying here is if you don't agree, then you're not really that smart. You're not in with the scientists. Now, there is a website now that's been made to disprove this idea that all scientists agree on this. Now, besides, we have to rely on evidence. It's a logical fallacy to say that you're going to make an appeal to the majority. The majority has been wrong frequently throughout history, and in science, that's been the case also. But let's look at this right here. This is A Descent from Darwin. You can visit the website. In order to sign on to this, you have to be a PhD scientist. And it says there is scientific descent from Darwinism. And they have their quote there, what you're signing on to. It says, "We are skeptical of claims for the ability of random mutation and natural selection to account for the complexity of life. Critical examination of the evidence for Darwinian theory should be encouraged." That's what these scientists are signing on to. They're saying, look, Darwinism is not a fact. This is not the law of evolution like the law of gravity or the laws of biogenesis or the laws of physics. This is still a theory. It's not established as a solid scientific fact. And so here are some of the people that have signed on to this. It's a huge document.
The National Center for Science Education did a parody of this. This guy goes on and on with his list. Project Steve pokes fun at this practice, and because Steves are only 1% of scientists, it also makes the point that tens of thousands of scientists support evolution. He's also very confused as to what a scientific theory and a law is. A scientific theory never becomes a fact, but it may contain facts, it may reference laws, and it also never becomes a law.
Regarding Lucy, the theory was that she was a missing link because she walked upright. They said her hip joint and her knee joint, maybe some of her neck, indicate that she walked upright. But the pygmy chimp stands upright today and doesn't make the pygmy chimp a missing link simply because it stands upright.
Well, the pygmy chimp or bonobo is not a transitional species, obviously, because it's alive today. They also are not obligate bipeds like Lucy's species was. That means they don't walk on two legs all the time, like her species would have.
The knee joint was found more than a mile away and 200 feet deeper in the ground. Very likely, Lucy was a chimpanzee.
Well, Lucy definitely wasn't a chimpanzee. If you look at the details between chimpanzees and Australopithecus afarensis, there were many differences in skeletal, dental, in the pelvis, just all throughout.
If you look at the Creation Museum, this is a replica of what was actually found. And you notice they don't have hands, they don't have feet. It's only 40% of the skeleton. But if you were to go to the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, this is what they have. Notice it has human hands, human-like hands, and human-like feet. This is to give more draw more of a conclusion that this is a missing link. And then if you go to Michigan State University, in their museum, they have skin and hair. They have her holding a stick. This just shows, hey, look it, she's on her way to becoming human, right? You might as well put a cell phone in her hand. Hey, there you have it. She's almost human.
This is one of my favorite creationist memes. We have over 400 different fossil specimens, parts of members of Australopithecus afarensis. We could reconstruct Lucy's entire anatomy without her fossil.
That's manipulation. That's not science. That's not evidence, that's manipulation of the facts. So again, what are the missing links really made of? Not very much. Okay, let's move on after Lucy. So we've got Ramapithecus here, we've got Java Man, we've got Lucy. What's the next one? It's Piltdown Man. Now, Piltdown Man was a total hoax.
Yes, Piltdown Man was a hoax, against science, not by scientists. It seems that Charles Dawson was responsible. He wasn't a scientist, he was an amateur fossil collector. I go into a lot of detail on this on my website, so I'm not really going to discuss it much here. I will say, though, that it was never really widely accepted, and it hasn't been used for evidence for anything in almost 70 years.
Okay, let's look at the next one. After Piltdown Man comes Neanderthal Man. Look at him there, a real handsy devil with a tux on there. If you've seen the Geico commercials, you know, you don't want to be racist towards a Neanderthal Man. Neanderthal Man is in the Smithsonian's Neanderthal exhibit. The bones were first unearthed in 1856 and were supposedly supporting Darwin's theory. Scientists discovered that some of the men were stooped over because of a bone disease, rickets, but most of them walked just like you and I. Today, Neanderthal Man has been reclassified as a normal human.
Neanderthals have always been considered human, just not Homo sapiens. Every species in the genus Homo is considered human.
And so, again, this is, people really want to believe that evolution's true, so they're not being objective in exploring and examining these skeletons.
The skeletons have been studied extensively. We know all the different anatomical features that separate us from Neanderthals. We also have genetic information that shows that they fall outside the range of modern humans.
So I want you to be skeptical the next time somebody comes up to you and says, hey, we found a missing link, or we found evidence that evolution is true. Be a little bit skeptical.
There it is, just another flat-out lie. Neanderthals are not classified as modern humans who were stooped over because of bone disease. It's almost as if this guy did almost all his research off of chick tracks.
Okay, after Neanderthal Man comes our last one that we're going to examine. It's named after a state in the U.S., which is Nebraska Man. The last one there you see on the right is full human, or what's called Cro-Magnon Man, which is just another way of saying human. Geologist Harold Cook found a tooth in Nebraska, and using that tooth, evolutionists claimed another missing link between monkey and man.
You don't have to believe that creationists constantly bring up Nebraska Man and Piltdown Man because they really haven't studied the evidence we have today for human evolution. This guy just spent his whole lecture talking about things we don't even use as evidence.
Okay, so invented based off of one tooth, which turned out to be the tooth from an extinct pig. Now, evolutionists will often line up a bunch of skulls of different shapes and sizes, and they'll say, look it, this is evidence of evolution. If you look at the first one there, it's looking right at you, letter A, and then they've got underneath it, they've got a sideways view of it. And what they're trying to do is show the gradual process of evolution. They say that that first one, a pan troglodyte chimpanzee, it's a modern monkey. Okay, that first one's monkey right
Chimps
there.
Chimps aren't monkeys.
And as you go through these, they date them. They have it 2.6 million years old, 2.5 million years old. And they keep going down the list, and you see it. It's changing. Homo habilis, 1.9 million years old.
Did you see your error there? There's Homo erectus after Lucy.
All the way until they get to the very last one. And if you see, you look at the very last one there on the right side, bottom right, Homo sapiens, modern human. Okay, and is this really evidence for evolution? Lining up all these skulls together, different shapes and sizes, and then saying, see, we evolved? No, there's no evidence, no observable, repeatable evidence of change from one kind of animal into another. This is simply lining up a bunch of skulls and saying, see, here we have it, scientific evidence. In fact, many people today have different skull sizes, but does that prove that evolution is taking place or that one is a missing link and one is a full human? No, that's silly.
Well, they're not lined up in just some random order. We're lining them up in order of age. And it's just indisputable that for the last 3 million years, we have an unbroken chain of transitional fossils that show transition from ape to human. So this same guy's got some other online courses that are equally as bad, and I'll be doing a critique of those too.
I said don't take everybody. before you're free. Free.